National Conference and Exhibition on Broadcast and Media Technology. Throughout the centuries, humans have made tremendous leaps forward in the way we build, interact, and communicate with each other and the world. More recently, we have shifted self-execute industrialization to the age of information. We now have a seemingly unlimited amount of knowledge available at our fingertips. Technological advances are now accelerating faster than ever before. They are blurring the lines between the physical, digital, and biological domains. As technology continues to evolve, we can expect it to impact all aspects of our lives and society. It then begs us to ask the question, what does our future look like? While we can only predict what our future will look like, we can start to see the possibilities are seemingly endless, and we are only beginning to see a small fraction of what may be to come. And with that aim in view, this year's theme for the Expo is Disruptive Technologies Shaping Future Broadcasting. We venture forth with this theme at heart to inquire and explore what is indeed awaiting us. With a varied theme every year, BES Expo has thrived in branching out to different arenas, reflecting the phenomenal growth of broadcasting sector in India. By hosting BES Expo annually, the society undoubtedly has augmented in curating a strong platform to unite the world of broadcasting. BES Expo stands as a global name to reckon with. And on this note, ladies and gentlemen, let me extend a very gracious welcome to a successive 26th edition of the BES Expo 2020. We are delighted to have among us our esteemed panel of dignitaries, and I will request the members of the audience to join me in extending a very hearty welcome to our esteemed chief guest, Sri Shashi Shekhar Vempathy, CEO, Prasar Bharati. A very good morning and very warm welcome, sir. Please join me in extending a warm welcome to our guest of honor, Sri Rajiv Singh, Member Finance, Prasar Bharati. A very warm welcome, sir. On that note, please join me in welcoming our keynote speaker for this year, Ms. Pamela Kumar, who is Director General, Telecommunications, Standard Development Society of India, and Vice President, Cloud Computing Innovation Council of India. A very warm welcome, ma'am. Let me also take this opportunity to extend a very cordial welcome to Sri CBS Maurya, who is the President of Broadcast Engineering Society India and Engineer-in-Chief All India Radio and Doordarshan. May I also extend a warm welcome to Sri Aftab Ahmed, who is the Honorary Secretary for Broadcast Engineering Society India, and Sri O.P. Rajpurohit, who is the Honorary Treasurer for Broadcast Engineering Society India. A very warm welcome to the entire team of the BES. Lastly, but very importantly, it is so humbling and so gratifying to look around and to see such bright, beautiful, and amazing minds here honoring this expo. And it actually is immense gratitude that we feel to see such a strong strength of audience. Indeed, it is reassuring to know that this year too will turn out to be a very successful BES Expo 2020. On that note, welcome everybody. May I request the dignitaries to kindly grace the stage and kindly please come on the stage and take the seats here on the dais. On behalf of the entire team of BES India, I will request Sri CBS Maurya, President BES, to welcome our Honorable Chief Guest Sri Shashi Shekhar Vempathy by presenting a flower bouquet. May I now request Sri Aftab Ahmed, Honorary Secretary BES, to please extend a hearty welcome to the guest of honor, Sri Rajiv Singh, with a flower bouquet. Very warm welcome, sir. May I now invite Sri O.P. Raj Purohit, Honorary Treasurer BES, to extend a gracious welcome to our keynote speaker, Ms. Pamela Kumar, by presenting a flower bouquet. A very, very warm welcome. Every year, officiating the proceedings of the conference, we facilitate the auspicious ceremony of lighting the lamp. And this year will not be different as well. If I may draw the parallels between the ethos of BES and the age-old tradition, then it will be quite apt to state that knowledge removes ignorance, just as light dispels darkness. So may I now humbly request our Honorable Chief Guest and our guest of honor, along with other dignitaries and keynote speaker, to kindly adhere to this auspicious ceremony. Please kindly preside over this auspicious ceremony as we move forward towards lighting the lamp.
वक्रतुंड महाकाय सूर्यकोटि समप्रभा निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा
I thank all the dignitaries for officiating this ceremony, this expo, this inauguration of the expo. And on that note, if I may request Sri CBS Maurya, President BES, to kindly come and address the audience with a welcome note. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together in welcoming Sri CBS Maurya.
Very good morning. Respected CEO Prasar Bharati, Sri Shashi Shekhar Vempathy ji, the chief guest today, Sri Rajiv Singh ji, Member Finance Prasar Bharati, the guest of honor, Ms. Pamela Kumar ji, DG TSDSI, the keynote speaker today, distinguished guests, exhibitors, delegates, media persons, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great sense of pride and immense pleasure to welcome such a learned gathering to this important broadcast event of 26th International Conference and Exhibition on Broadcast and Media Technology organized by Broadcast Engineering Society India. Respected Chief Guest Sir, I extend a very warm welcome to you to this inaugural ceremony. Your presence is a great source of inspiration for the broadcasting fraternity assembled here and will certainly help in taking this event to a greater heights. I also extend a very cordial welcome to Sri Rajiv Singh ji, Member Finance, Prasar Bharati. Sir, you have been always encouraging and motivating the broadcast professionals. I also extend very cordial welcome to Ms. Pamela Kumar, Director General, Telecommunications Standards Development Society. She has kindly agreed to deliver the keynote speech today. I welcome distinguished guests, exhibitors, delegates, and media persons here. BS was started in 1987 with an objective to promote the advancement, dissemination of knowledge and practices in the field of broadcasting and related technologies. Since then, it has grown enormously. To meet these objectives, the Society conducts conferences, seminars, tutorials, and exhibitions regularly. Society also promotes technical innovations and excellence by facilitating prestigious BES awards to individuals for their outstanding contributions in the field of broadcast engineering every year. The signature event of the Society is this BES Expo, an international conference and exhibition, which is conducted annually. This event is supported by Prasar Bharati, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union, Society of Broadcast Engineers of USA, AES India, and DRM. Every year, BES Expo has a theme on the current broadcast scenario, and this year's theme is Disruptive Technologies Shaping Future Broadcasting. There is a demand for consuming content anytime, anywhere, and any device nowadays. The recent worldwide development in the field of broadband have made availability of high-speed broadband affordable to the maximum population. This has led to the availability of audio, video, and TV content on internet-based platforms. Technological advances in broadcasting, both in India and worldwide, are trending towards a convergence of broadcasting and mobile broadband technologies. This is expected to deepen further with the development of 5G technology. India is expected to be one of the largest open markets for consumption of digital media content by the turn of the decade, with a huge increase in content consumption through mobile devices like smartphones, tablets, and laptops. Linear broadcast TV consumption has been on the decline, even though it is still the first choice for many consumers. The emerging ecosystem is complex, diverse, richer, and highly interactive. And to sustain the business, it requires certainly out-of-box thinking and quick adaptability to the new standards, expectations, and way of life. I hope tutorials and conference session spread over 3 days will be able to address current scenario, issues, challenges, and opportunities, and will be able to drive Indian broadcast industry towards future readiness. Once again, I welcome all to this BES Expo 2020. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your welcome note. On that note, let me now request our keynote speaker, Ms. Pamela Kumar, to kindly come and deliver her keynote. Just a very quick intro about ma'am here. She is an alumnus of PES Chandigarh and IIM Bangalore. She brings with her an experience of 30 plus years in the communications, computers, and semiconductor industry. As one of her many illustrious facets, she's also the founding chair and current president of Cloud Computing Innovation Council of India. She is the Bharati Chair for IT Research and Member Research Council, UIET, and Punjab University. Please join me in extending a very warm welcome to Ms. Pamela Kumar.
So good morning, everybody, and welcome to this BES Expo. It's indeed an honor for me to be here. So I really appreciate the gesture from the Broadcast Society to have given me this opportunity. And I hope I'm able to do justice to this honor today. So at the very outset, I would say that we are going to be talking about disruptive technologies. Do I get my presentation up? And clicker or something? The presentation is right here? Okay. Okay. So, you know, when... So definitely there is a disruption happening, right, in technology. And this disruption...
Can this be a clicker?
This is a clicker. Okay. So the disruption is... underlying this disruption is really convergence. It's about the technologies converging together. The IT technology, the silos that we were used to. So technology matured in the silos. It was very important for them to be separate to mature. But now has come the time for convergence and collaboration. So when one of our members came to us in TSDSI to start a study topic around broadcast, we conducted a workshop, right? And we were told, so we have several people who've been associated with DOT and all, and they said, no. You will never get anybody from broadcast ministry. Broadcast and DOT, they have a long-standing wall, a very impermeable wall between them, which you cannot afford to break. But most surprisingly for us, Mr. Shekhar Vempathy, he came in very humbly. None of us really knew him. He walked in and he gave this amazing presentation, and it really started a great beginning for us and really opened up the barriers in one shot. And I think today marks that next step, that next big step that we are all going to take together in collaboration and convergence, and really creating from that 1 - 1 = 0, we are going to go to 1 + 1 = 11, right? So I'm hoping that this is the journey that we are on. So coming from the communication and IT sector, I would be talking more about the disruptions there, and then I humbly venture into what I believe is the role of broadcast there. So this is what I want to talk about today. I'll talk about the 5G disruption, and as we're looking at 5G, 5G is being called the next big disruption in industrial revolution, right? And why is it disruptive? Because these technologies of IT and communications, which developed, have matured to a point where 5G is all about taking them into all the verticals. These are not verticals anymore. They are horizontals. They are going to span across every aspect of our life. And I believe that 5G also represents an opportunity for India to lead this change. So we'll dwell over that for some time on why is this an opportunity for India to lead the change. Then we go a little deeper into India's story on what are some of the challenges as we are trying to embrace these new and emerging technologies, and what are some of the initiatives we have started taking in this direction. As I said, I'll talk about what's the role of broadcast, and finally a call for action. So what's changing? And what is technology disrupting? So as I said, life is changing. Technology today is permeating into every aspect of our lives and is going to transform it radically. Just a phone, just a mobile phone has impacted so many facets of our life. But just imagine all these new technologies. And here are some examples, right? Out of these, I would just pick a couple. So the way houses were built, right? You went to an architect, he built a blueprint. He doesn't do that anymore. There is no blueprint. There is actually a virtual image of the house. You can walk through it, you can feel it, you can almost have a walkthrough of what this building is going to look like, even before any construction happens. And once that design is there and you are comfortable with it, that information gets transferred to a 3D printer, which may be there out there in the field, and it just constructs your building, right? It's possible. It's possible today. And it's all because of technology, right? Remote surgery, people talk about precision agriculture using drones, right? We've talked about that. Automation in the manufacturing industry with the robots talking, communicating directly with each other and making adjustments. I mean, the Maruti factory, if you ever visited it, even almost 20 years back, they already were fully robotized, and every single car flowing through is not the same car. There would be an 800 followed by a Desire, followed by, you know, in different colors, and it's not assembly line anymore. It's full customization, right? So that's how things are changing. And so what's enabling it? What's enabling is this new stack of technology. So the stack of technology, starting with nanotechnologies, green technologies, going on to the converged systems, mobile and communication systems, cognitive computing, cloud computing, artificial intelligence and machine learning, immersive technologies, right? The autonomous UAVs and drones and robots, Internet of Things, social media. These are all the new technologies. But what are they? They are essentially building blocks. They are building blocks for finding solutions to what you want to change or make better in every single vertical facet, whether it's education or healthcare or manufacturing or, you know, every facet of your life. These are the building blocks that you are using to define how to create a new world. And by the way that innovation is happening, the way these technologies are being developed and deployed and matured has become a very open world. And technology itself is enabling this open world. So it's all about people coming together in open forums. That's what's driving the direction of technology. You don't, a company within a closed door or within a premise of even a global company, they cannot afford to do the kind of innovation that happens in an open forum. And Linux is the primary example of that, right? I when I started my career, there was an AT&T Unix, there was a Sun Solaris Unix, and there was an HP Unix, and every company has its IBM Unix. Okay, everybody had their Unix. But where are they? They're all dead. It's only Linux. And Linux was developed in an open forum. All the developers, all the technologists, they came together in open forums. They've never met each other. They're working all of their tens of thousands of engineers working all over the world, developing this new operating system, which is there in every machine today, right? It's the most robust one because all the ideas and the testing that has, no company can afford to do it. And this was done for free. People came together with their own passion, their own ideas, and they contributed discretionary effort. And their companies encourage them to contribute this discretionary effort, right? So that's the open world today. Everything is open out there. So what are these applications of technology? Going back to the 5G triangle, the famous 5G triangle, enhanced broadband, machine-to-machine connectivity, ultra-reliable, low latency, and they're all a plethora of applications, right? Besides all the wonderful applications that you can make happen on your cell phone, It's about smart agriculture. It's about mobility on high-speed trains. If you're watching a movie, you move from you're walking from your car to your train to you're walking as a pedestrian. No disruption in your audio or video that's streaming with you. The artificial reality, augmented reality, and virtual reality experience, the immersive experiences that come with it. The smart cities that we are trying to build. The smart meters that we are trying to put into the utilities, and the smart vehicles, right? So these are some of the applications out there. So essentially, as I said again, this is to reinforce that the way that we work, live, and play, and even go to war is changing drastically. Okay, there's a joint warfare think tank which is coming and talking to us. So they can't talk about Navy, Army, and Air Force separately anymore. They have to manage it together. They have to look at it as a converged platform along with cyber security, along with cyber warfare. So they're looking at it all together. They can't look at it in silos anymore, right? So fintech, edutech, agritech, so smart cities, smart villages, health tech, industry, smart transport, utilities, smart warfare. This is what this technology is creating. It's changing the way these traditional core industries used to look like. It's going to change drastically. And we have to be the enablers of this change. Going back to the telecom sector, where I come from, on what has caused the change so far, let's look back on the history of telecom. Way back in the 80s, okay, when, I personally came back from the US and we were settling down here, there were a more than six month waiting list to get a telephone connection. And why was that? Because we had less than 2 to 3 million landlines and maybe another 5 to 10 million waiting list. And we were adding landlines at the rate of 400,000 lines per year. Why? Because we were importing. We were importing equipment, and that's all we could afford, right? So then what happened? Somebody had the vision, was able to convince the government, let's build our own telephone exchange. So we built our own telephone exchange. Lo and behold, the cost of what was $1,000 per line or something cost, we brought it down to from 20,000 rupees per line, we brought it down to 5,000 rupees per line cost, okay? And we put 50 million lines of this technology indigenously designed into the, we created STD booths, India-specific innovation, that in a poor country like ours, you can walk and you can make a phone call, and that's all we can afford. But we made one jump. And then, lo and behold, a new technology came. Wireless. And where did wireless take us? Right? Interestingly, at that point, even though we had designed a wireless base station, it got stuck in some of the bureaucracy in the government, never got approved, that project never got approved. But our neighboring country had designed equipment which we could import at 1,000 rupees per line cost. And that enabled us to create this network, which is over a billion subscribers, right? Let's go further. So that was the 2G story. So what happened with 3G, 4G? So as you can see, the adoption of technology in India has always been this lying down hockey stick. And what is it? It takes us a while. New technology comes. We wake up to new technology. We start putting it in the country. We start importing it. We release the tenders and the RFPs. We buy this new equipment, start putting it, start understanding how it will work in our country. And by the time we figure it out, then it picks up. It picks up exponentially, right? And it disrupts us. So what I am saying is that this lying down hockey stick now in the 5G era needs to become a standing up hockey stick. Let's all get together and hold up this hockey stick and make it a standing up hockey stick where we engage with new and emerging technologies and meet the demand in this country in a standing up manner rather than the lying down manner. And you know, this is all about engineering the future. I have the 5G triangle here, but we could as well have put the spectrum here on how we are going to choose different parts of the spectrum to utilize it more efficiently. Maybe I should have changed that picture, right? And how we can deliver all these applications that our society is hungry for, which is going to be the basis of our transformation. So what needs to change? In order to make this happen, what needs to change? We need to start thinking differently about embracing technology. It needs to be about collaboration, interdisciplinary, interdepartmental, inter-industry collaboration, We need to come together. We need to understand what are our use cases. We need to get engaged with demonstrations of early emerging technology and research and develop those use cases further, convert them into proof of concepts, develop requirements which are driven from our needs. Then we need to engage and invest in getting trials done, pilots done, setting up interoperability test beds, going and developing standards, influencing global standards to meet our needs and requirements so that the ecosystem develops technology which meets our needs at the price point that we need it for, right? So the hardening of technology in this process, before we get into acquisition mode, we have always had this consumer mindset where somebody develops technology for their own needs and they comes and tell us, by the way, this will be good for you also. And we try to understand from the vendor what our needs are. Rather than telling the vendor, this is what we need, and please develop technology which meets our needs, right? We need to get out of that mindset. So how do you go about that? How do you influence the direction of technology to make a leapfrog? That is very unique about us. We have the opportunity to leapfrog in generations and embrace new. We don't have to go the evolutionary way. We need to revolutionize because we have a big catch-up to do here. Okay, we need to embrace emerging technology. And a platform like TSDSI, which brings together government, industry, academia, startups on a common platform to discuss, to engage, to develop standards, to do interoperabilities, right, to develop use cases. These are the kind of platform that we need to collaborate around to make this jump. So let's dive a little deeper into the India story. So what's happening in India? We all know. From a smart city, smart grid, smart nation, the Digital India vision of transforming India into a digitally empowered society and knowledge economy. So our leapfrog from a developing economy to a developed economy has to be based on technology. There is no other go. We can't do what the other countries have done, right? What the West did, we don't have the luxury of doing that, right? We are not a closed system like China that we can exploit. The only tool, the only weapon we have is technology to emerge from a developing country to a developed country. So when we try to embrace this technology, everybody tells us, well, it works in our country, you can make it, it should work there too. Why do you want something different? So let's do some back of the envelope calculations, okay? Let's look at the area. So North America and Europe, their area combined is 34.89 million square kilometers. India is 3.287 million square kilometers. Directly a factor of 1:10, right? Now let's look at the population. Interestingly, the population of North America and Europe is 1.323 billion and that of India is 1.324 billion. So any technologist out there knows that if they have to design for India, right? If you have to put IoTs or cell phones or any other devices, the consumption is going to be different. It's different. Yeah? Now let's look at GDP. Their GDP is 57 trillion and we are at 2.64, maybe 3 trillion now. Right? More than 1/20. That's why mobile happened only when we talked about 40 paisa phone call. And the 100 rupee ARPU per person per month is the only way that 5G is going to happen in this country, which is very different. But is it possible? Of course it's possible, right? And why is it possible? It's possible because in Janpath, the sarson ka saag and makki ki roti that you get for 40 rupees is probably the best in the world. You can go to Leela Palace or Lalit or whatever, and for 2,000 rupees, you're not going to get the same thing, right? So that's why it's possible. And we know how to make it possible. And then let's look at power consumption. Power consumption, 1,378 watts per person. And India, 87 watts per person. What if we want to live like they do in the US and Europe, right? We want the same lifestyle, why not? We want the same quality of life. That's what we all aspire for. That's why our kids keep running away there. We want that life here. But if we are going to consume the same power that they are consuming, the whole world will fry. So we have to think differently. Now let's look at some of the other challenges. Rural broadband. When we were sitting in ITU, they were talking about rural EMBB, rural enhanced mobile broadband. And what were the proposals on the table? The proposals on the table were that in North America and Europe, they have highways on which there are vehicles running at 125 kilometers per hour on which they want undisrupted broadband. China had 500 kilometers per hour bullet trains running through its villages on which they want uninterrupted broadband. And we said, well, we're not going to have 125 kilometers per hour vehicle or 500 kilometers per hour bullet train in our village. 70% of our population lives in the village. We want uninterrupted broadband in his hands, whether he is walking or at maximum going at 30 kilometers per hour in a vehicle. That's what we need. That's our requirement. At 100 rupees ARPU per month, right? So that's different, right? And the way our villages are, we'll talk a little bit more about fiber to the panchayat later. Look at the diversity, language diversity, culture diversity, geographical diversity. We know all about it. Cherrapunji, Thar Desert, Kanyakumari, Kashmir, right? We have to meet all these. When you put your towers, you have to meet all those extreme conditions to make it work. And then it is greenfield. We are still greenfield. I think we've missed a few generations, so when we are trying to revamp to the next generation, we have to leapfrog. So leapfrog in socioeconomic development enabled by technology. That's the story of India. It's technology for development. Not for business, not for profit. That's the way the rest of the world looks at it. Now, when we consume technology, we consume it differently. So here are some examples to say that India is probably the world's most fertile market in 5G adoption. In fact, interestingly, I haven't put that point here, but we had a workshop recently where all the operators, the telecom operators, presented. And they said that their towers, their base stations today are operating, 4G towers are operating at 80 to 90% utilization. We had guys from Sprint and Verizon and, you know, all these guys from North America and Europe, the operators there, and they said even now they don't, 30%, 40%, 50% is what is their standard operating points, right? Look at the consumption of what these two tell you. I can hardly read it here, but let me, yeah, okay. So broadband consumption in India. Active internet users, right? Active internet users in India, 462 million, 430 million of them are consuming it on the phone. That doesn't happen in North America and Europe. Social media users, 250 million, 230 million are consuming social media on the phone, right? Today we are number one data consumption in the India. I am saying 11 gigabytes. Just last week somebody was talking about 15 gigabytes is the number now. 15 gigabytes per user per month is what India is consuming. The rate at which we adopted 4G, Reliance only launched 4G in 2017. Right? With voice free. And 90% of the devices sold into 2017 were 4G. 65 to 70% of the consumption of this data is in video. And that video, what is that video? 90% in regional languages. You and I don't have the time to sit and watch the video. Right? It's the other. So that's where the diversity comes. So the broadcast tower, or the tower which is supplying a neighborhood where there is a gated community, right, where the five-star locality, and then there is the slum next door. They probably have more subscribers in the slum consuming more data than the guys in the gated community. They're probably getting more ARPU from there. So what are some of the initiatives? So there's a National Digital Communication Policy which has come out, a very good document worth looking at. Marching towards the future with aspiration and determination is the tagline there. It talks about connect India, propel India, secure India, and I won't dwell too much into it. Except that one very nice thing that they have done is set very clear goals, 2022 numeric goals, measurable metrics by which we are going to pursue. And that's driving a lot of energy and a lot of excitement. There was a 5G high-level forum. For the first time, Department of Science and Technology, Department of Telecommunication, Department of IT, the three secretaries were meeting almost every month together. And once a month almost, we used to have a whole day meeting. And they would make it a point to be there from morning till evening. And that's how we came out. There were these seven or eight task forces and different aspects, spectrum, regulatory, use case labs, major trials, application layer standards, participation in all these things were addressed, and a report making India 5G ready was there. And what's India must embrace this opportunity by deploying 5G networks early, efficiently, and pervasively, as well as emerge as a significant innovator and technology supplier at the global level. So that's what was driving us. And, you know, there were professors, there were the directors of all IITs, there was a CEO of Reliance Jio, there was a CEO of Airtel, there was a CTO of TCS and Wipro, and, you know, all the who's who, the best brains in the country were coming together month on month together along with the secretaries and working on this seriously, diligently. That's what it takes to collaborate. There's a 5G test bed that has been put together. Right, 35 million, 250 crores has been put. IIT Delhi, IIT Mumbai, IIT Kanpur, IIT Hyderabad, ISC Bangalore, IITM, CIVETS, and you know, all of them are coming together. Startups are getting associated with it. More than 200 people have been hired into these test labs, and a lot of innovation is being driven out of them. This is the low mobility large cell proposal which we have taken to ITU. From the first time from India, a technology proposal has been taken and made a part of the specifications of IMT 2020. IMT 2020 is the name for 5G that ITU has. And what is this proposal? That our villages, we have a gram panchayat to which BharatNet is giving the fiber. And around that are fields and small, small hamlets of villages. In order to cover them, we cannot put base stations everywhere. It will be too expensive. So, as I said, what were the proposals on the table? The proposals on the table were for rural EMBB, inter-site distance of 1.732 kilometers, and these kind of mobility speeds. We said no. We actually took a proposal with 12 kilometers. That's the technology that has been developed in our research labs. That inter-site distance of 12 kilometers at 30 kilometers per hour is what we need in our country. Right? And that's the technology. So we had to negotiate, you know, all the vendors opposed us, so we had to negotiate it down to 6. But we are currently, this is the specification, this is the requirements document, what went became mandatory in the requirements document. Okay, all the developing countries came forward to support us. All the developed countries were opposing us big time. Okay? But we have submitted a technology proposal in parallel, which contains all our innovations which we feel India needs, which we are still struggling to make it part of the 5G standards. Now, what can broadcast do? So if we look into this network, video is flooding the network. What is the cause for your call drops and all the low quality voice? Because of video. Video consumption, streaming video. It should be going on the broadcast network. What's it doing on the cellular network? Right? Can we fix that problem? That's an India-specific problem. The consumption of video in India, 52% in 2017, is now 77%, growing at a 69% CAGR. If the broadcast community does not come to help, the cellular network will collapse. Right? So what's the vision? The vision is we need to create a broadcast slice. along with the mobile broadband, the machine to machine, the reliable low lit, it needs to be a broadcast slice. Is it 6G or whether it is broadcast video or the other? I think the point that I didn't mention is the best way to deliver video is in the UHF range. And you are the owner of that range, right? Broadcast receiver enabled devices. I think some of you went to Sankhya Labs and said that that device is already there, ready to be launched in the country. And the CDN architecture. So whatever is the content, whether it's broadcast content or internet content or voice content, all of that coming to a converged core and then going to the right tower. And lo and behold, if you go for the low power, low tower technologies, you can actually share infrastructure. That brings the cost down, the maintenance, everything so much lower. And why not? Right? So that's the thoughts I would like to leave you with. On what broadcast can do to enable, to help us lift this hockey stick and make it a standing up hockey. Let's lift this hockey stick together and create this big revolution. And by the way, it makes business sense. There's a lot of monetization that the broadcaster can do. The telco will offload video and pay you for it. The mobile phone will, some part of that ARPU will come to you. The automotive industry will have use cases to use your network. The advertising fees, money is anyway there with you, right? So there are different ways in which it will open up a whole new world of monetization to the broadcast industry. So what's the call for action? So TSDSI is a body where we are bringing the ecosystem together. And our objective obviously is on standardization, but we do a lot of pre-standardization work as well. And standards, by the way, is what I call is the Sagar Manthan. So all the knowledge and all the expertise you pour into the Sagar, and then the Sur Asur Danav, right? The broadcast, the satellite, and the communication, all of us have to come together and churn this ocean to bring out that pot of Amrit. So, you know, we are a membership-driven organization, organizations from across academia and equipment manufacturers and software guys and service providers, PSUs, R&D, they're all members, and we welcome you to join us. It's been a tough journey. In these 5 to 6 years, we have learned that standards is not easy. It's important. We have realized that standards are important if we really want to become a globally competitive in deployment of technology, globally competitive in innovation and contribution to the global pot of technology. But standards takes a while to understand. It requires long-term commitment. Any proposal you take, you have to pursue it for 2 to 3 years, 7 to 8 meetings per year across the globe. If you lose even one meeting, you're gone. Right? So it's taken us a while, but we are beginning to have success. We've gone through our forming, norming, storming, norming phases. These are some of the topics. And as you can see, you know, NAVIC, we just did NAVIC. Satellite communication, NAVIC was a standard. It had been created in ISRO. It was not going anywhere. China had their navigation protocol. Russia had their own. GPS was there. Our NAVIC was just there in ISRO. Reliance Jio, who is a member of 3GPP, member of TSDSI, said, what's happening? Let's take it. They took the front end. Now ISRO has become a member. Now ISRO is going to front end it, and we brought it into 3GPP. It's going to become a standard, right? Where every cell phone will have, they have already implemented it in the chips. NAVIC is one of the navigation things which is going to happen on every chip, mobile phone now, okay? So spectrum studies, broadcast offload, you know, then security, privacy, all those other nice things. Topics are there. We request you to come and join us. We have a roadmap committee. By the way, our roadmap committee workshop meeting is on March 4th in Delhi. You're very welcome to come and join us and put some roadmap items or engage with the others as we are developing the roadmap for the next few years. And as I said, when you join a body like TSDSI, It's there are pre-standardization activities, workshops, consultations, global collaborations, conferences, and obviously the standardization activities where you work within TSDSI and you go to the global platforms as well. And as I said, it's hard work. It requires deep commitment, deep investments. So if you are the person who wants to join a standards body and you go to your boss and your boss tells you that you need a bunch of approvals, come to us and we will go talk to your boss. Okay? But if you are the boss, I request you to please encourage your people to join these open forums and open platforms. It will open up a whole new world for them and bring in a lot more innovation and energy into your organization. So thank you very much. The standards is about collaboration and consensus building, and it's a lot of fun. So we invite you all to join hands with us. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please extend a very warm thank you to Ms. Pamela Kumar for such an insightful keynote address. Thank you very much, ma'am, for your significant and valuable input. On that note, let's move on to the next segment of the inaugural ceremony. If I may request Sri Shashi Shekhar Vempati, CEO Prasar Bharati, to kindly release the conference proceedings for the exhibition 2020, please. All right, on that note, that is the release of the conference proceedings. Thank you very much, sir, for releasing it. And all the esteemed dignitaries as well. Thank you very much. On a very quick note, if I may just do a humble request to Sri Shashi Shekhar ji to kindly present one small award, please. It is a Lifetime Achievement Award which is being presented for the exemplary contribution in broadcasting. And may I now request Sri H.K. Vadva, who is the former Engineer-in-Chief Doordarshan, to kindly come and please accept the honor. Please, a very warm welcome, a very gracious applaud for Sri H.K. Vadva ji. So, ladies and gentlemen, an author and a columnist and an innovator, Sri Vempati is the youngest and the first non-bureaucratic CEO of India's public broadcaster since 2017, and is currently overseeing the transformation of the twin networks of Doordarshan and All India Radio. A technocrat, he is an alumnus of Indian Institute of Technology, IIT Bombay. After a long stint at Infosys Technologies, he managed a digital news media startup, Neeti Digital, for taking up his current role in public broadcasting. Ladies and gentlemen, please extend a very warm welcome for Sri Shashi Shekhar Vempati, CEO Prasar Bharati. Sir.
Good morning and a warm welcome to everyone to the Broadcast Expo. I missed last year's expo. Unfortunately, I was not well, so it's good to be back here. I see that the BES Society, which brings together all broadcast engineers, has grown in size. I recently had the good fortune to attend two of your local chapters in Bangalore and Hyderabad. So I believe there are 12 local chapters, 2,500 members, clearly a vibrant community. But as we are seeing from the excellent keynote address by Pamela ji, the technology landscape is fast changing. The silos are vanishing. Convergence is happening across domains, which also means that broadcasting has to align itself with these changes. Otherwise, we will be left out of this fast changing technology landscape. So it's very important that broadcasting community needs to collaborate more, perhaps BES as a expo, as a standalone event, in the past perhaps made sense, but maybe going forward you probably should co-locate with some of the other bigger industry events that are happening, be it in the telecom space, the mobile space, the media space, so that there's more collaboration, more exchange of ideas, cross-pollination, because that is the key need of the hour. Because increasingly what we are doing, when I look at our decadal vision, what will Prasar Bharati be 10 years from now? I think it would be less and less like Doordarshan and All India Radio of the past, and more like an Amazon, YouTube of the future. Because we will be increasingly operating out of the cloud, we will be increasingly using algorithms and software, we will be more and more automated, more and more IT enabled. So it's a dramatically different kind of an enterprise, public media enterprise, that you will see 10 years from now. And for that vision to be realized, we have to be much more closer to the changes that are happening in these other industries. And I don't think that's a matter of choice anymore, it's a matter of survival. So if broadcasting has to survive and thrive, it has to get closer to these bigger shifts that are happening in the broader technology landscape. One of our aspirations, maybe 10 years from now, is can we be a $1 billion enterprise? I think it's very much possible. When I look at the other public broadcasters, being a $1 billion revenue enterprise is not that impossible. We are already, fairly large in size. It's just that, we have to build up that momentum. So 10 years from now, that's very much a realistic goal. If India has to become a $5 trillion economy, why can't Prasar Bharati be a $1 billion enterprise, right? So that's one of our decadal visions. Can we offer the largest bouquet of free-to-air content? Today, we are already operating Freedish. We are operating a very large radio network. So again, this is very much in the realm of possibilities. We offer, widest bouquet of diversity of content in languages and dialects. So very much possible to think of perhaps a 50 million plus household target. Today we are, I think, about 30 million. We can easily go to 50 million. And then I think the big shift will be when we can do direct to mobile broadcasting. If we can go down this path that Pamelaji was describing on 5G and how broadcast offload may happen. So can we get to every mobile phone with direct broadcasting? I think potentially then your base, you're talking of hundreds of millions of users. And that's, I think, very much doable if we get the roadmap right and we do the right innovations now. Then a few years from now, we could be directly broadcasting to hundreds of millions of people. So that's, I think, a very likely scenario. Digital growth is going to be key. We are already seeing tremendous growth. 3 years back when I joined Prasar Bharati, we were barely a few lakhs in digital revenues or traffic. I think this year we'll hit our first crore, and that's just the beginning. I think the upside is, and there's a lot of room for upside and growth there in digital side. The archives are a great example. Then today is World Radio Day, and I think what we did with the News on Air app to put 200 plus live streams on a mobile app for radio anywhere in India, I think is a fantastic innovation. I don't think any broadcaster in the world has that. So all of that is going to create avenues for our digital growth going forward. But all of this will happen only if we transform the way we work. We have to think cloud, we have to think automated, we have to think IT and software and algorithms. That's the only way this change is going to happen. We cannot operate the way we operated in the past. I think that's the imperative, that's the need of the hour. With that, I need to rush to another event for World Radio Day. So I'll take your leave. I hope you have a great conference, and I'm sure Rajiv will have a lot more interesting stuff to share. All the best, and look forward to a bigger BES next year, perhaps on a bigger platform. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. And before you take a leave, may I please request Sri CBS Maurya ji to please present a memento as a token of our appreciation to Sri Shashi Shekhar Vempathy, CEO, Prasar Bharati. Thank you very much, sir, for taking out time and gracing this occasion. Thank you very much. We thank you again, sir, for taking out time and gracing this expo this year as well. Thank you very much. Now, on that note, let's proceed with a different segment, with another segment of the expo inaugural ceremony. And if I may invite Sri Rajiv Singh, Member Finance, Prasar Bharati, to kindly do the honors and release the exhibitors directory for us along with the other dignitaries. We are now going to proceed to the release of the exhibitors directory by Sri Rajiv Singh, Member Finance, Prasar Bharati. If I may request the other dignitaries as well to kindly join in. With that, the exhibitors directory for BES Expo 2020. Thank you very much, sir, for doing the honors. And if I may now please request you to kindly come and address the audience for us. Please, ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming Sri Rajiv Singh.
Good morning to you all. And a very happy World Radio Day. It's a very difficult task to speak on technology when two very eloquent speakers have already shared so much of knowledge with you. I think almost more than 50% of broadcasting engineering talent is present here today. Whatever I have learned in broadcasting, technology, and engineering, it is from all of you only. So I would share how disruptive technologies have emerged and shaped the world for last 50, 70 years, or some examples from last century also. When the motor cars were invented, you know what was the problem they were going to solve? Pollution. There was a big problem of pollution by horse manure in cities like New York and London. There was a big crisis of 1894 where they said these big countries would be covered by 9 feet of horse manure. And then Mr. Ford converted motor to automobiles, and it was thought that we have, or humanity has, once for all solved the problem of pollution. Today, through the same invention, we are still trying to find out what are the ways to reduce pollution. Broadcasting itself has been a big disruption for print industry. Today, the effect of print industry is continuously overawed by digital, video, and radio. I was hearing and noting down, Mr. Maurya had mentioned disruptive technologies are there in terms of mobiles, apps, smart screens, and computing powers. Yes, these are there. But I personally feel that the challenges and disruption to broadcasting are going to come from innovations in various other supporting or complementary products, which are increasing at a very rapid pace. The first one, you remember we used to hear radio and TV for Chitrahar and Binaka Geet Malas, and people used to like songs and playlists of Amin Siani, and almost everybody might have heard those things. Then the invention came of miniaturization of storage devices. I am sure most of us have used MP3 players and iPods, where we could use and keep big playlists in the smallest devices. That was the first indication that disruption for broadcasting has started. Today's caravan is an example where business model, IP rights, and miniaturization of storage has created a product for Saregama which is very, very successful. Another invention I would like to talk about, all of us are using it every day, Bluetooth. It's very interesting how the name Bluetooth came up for use. Bluetooth was the name of a Danish king who brought together Denmark, Sweden, and Norway and created a single kingdom. Today, Bluetooth is joining our devices, our phones, our headsets, our earplugs, our computers. That's again an invention which is disrupting how we used to hear entertainment, news, and sports in yesterday's time. What I foresee, the biggest challenge for broadcasting is going to come from one major field, that is artificial intelligence. Siri and Alexa have already started following your commands and serving you whatever you want. And they are very benevolent also. I'll share one example. I use Alexa and I use iPhones also. So one day on iPhone, I said, Alexa, please put up a morning alarm at 6. The reply was, I am Siri, your morning alarm has been fixed. Had it been in a human condition, it would have become complicated. A lot of research is taking place in artificial intelligence and through deep learning, where computers are learning to mimic human behavior and becoming better at recognizing images, speech, and even facial expressions. This feature will find application in many fields, including broadcasting. Imagine if Alexa and Siri start recognizing Bhojpuri, Haryanvi, Bundelkhandi, and Mathura's language, and the old lady asks for her favorite songs and they are able to deliver it. That is not very far. I'm very sure this sort of feature is going to come in through advancement of artificial intelligence. And imagine just by a wink or by a facial expression that you are not liking this song, it automatically offers, okay, which songs do you want to listen to? These are the innovations which are going to disrupt broadcasting in near future. A very big innovation, emergence of lithium-ion batteries. Keep on recharging again and again. The frequency of running to the power source is decreasing. You don't have to be plugged in to a continuous source of electricity to use your devices. You can now be listening to news, watch sports, and songs on the move. The more will be such betterment in these technologies, the more mobility will be available to the customers, and this would be a challenge to the broadcasting industry, how to keep up with such pace of innovations. One thing I would like to share with you, what I personally feel. No matter how innovative a technology is, it becomes disruptive only when it is matched with a practical, financially viable business model. Today, Netflix might be seen by almost all of the people over here. It was started in 1997 as an alternative service to delivery of CDs of blockbusters and new release movies. They started serving customers by giving an online platform. But the real growth came in only when the broadband networks became so robust that with the snap of the finger, you could transfer data, huge amount of data in a big way. So any technology to become disruptive has to find a viable business model. Here from broadcasting field, one example comes to my mind, which is very much practical from India. Our DRM transmitters. We are using those transmitters for many years now. What I see with all of us, there is a small window of time available where we have to give the biggest push possible through cooperation and collaboration of all, if you want this disruptive technology to succeed. These technologies have effect on the job fit of all engineers and journalists who are there in the broadcasting industry. Today, I feel a graduate with the knowledge of computing application is equally suitable for broadcasting industry, if not more, as a student of mass communication. So we have to look at various skill sets also within ourselves and bring it on board if broadcasting industry has to face this disruptive technologies. The most important ingredients to face disruption for public broadcaster, in my opinion, are three. One, skill manpower, and skill has to be continuously upgraded and improved. All these technological innovations which we have talked about and many more which we haven't talked about, we broadcasters have to find ways to assimilate them and find unique applications in our world. And all of us have to do it. The other unique feature which incumbent broadcasters has is IPR on unique content, be it political news, be it sports, and the treasury of archives which I have is very valuable and will be very useful for times in future. Because agar kisi ko KL Sehgal ka gana sunna hai aur Suraiya ka gana sunna hai aur Sardar Patel ki speech sunni hai, toh woh toh mere paas hi milegi. So your IPR is a very big resource on which you should leverage to protect or foolproof yourself from future disruptive technologies. And one of the most important one is ability to serve the large segment of customers non-linearly. 2-3 years ago, I think in 2016, in BES forum only, I had mentioned that linear broadcasting is losing its sheen. I'm sure it has become more evident in last 2-3 years. And here again, the incumbent broadcaster is a big resource to be able to deliver on long reach and high volume of data due to the spectrum. We have to find applications, as Madam Pamela had said, as soon as possible to garner these unique opportunities we have, and we'll be mistaken if we overlook this disruptive trend. We have all these unique advantages to take disruptive technologies onslaught. We have the skill set, we have the spectrum, we have unique content, and we have the will to do it. I have just indicated what we can expect from the future so that we become future-proof, future-ready. And on this World Radio Day, I wish you all the best that we will face the onslaught successfully of these disruptive technologies. All the best to you all.
Thank you, Sri Rajiv Singh, for your insightful key address. Thank you very much. With that, let's move on to the next segment of the inaugural ceremony. As we are aware that Broadcast Engineering Society endorses the ideology of innovation and fosters a professional climate within the fraternity by propelling a pragmatic view of dissemination of knowledge and practices through its prestigious BES awards. Yes, I think you must have guessed it by now. We are moving towards the next segment of distributing our BES awards. The Society not only acknowledges the exemplary efforts made, but also prides in forefronting them on the global pedestal. Therefore, let me now request our esteemed dignitaries to kindly present the recipients of the eminent BES Awards for 2020. I will now call upon the name of the recipients of the awards. For Venkateshwaralu Nuri Award for Technical Workshop on Maintenance and Repair of RNS Make TV Transmitters, may I request Sri Satyapal DDE ADGE North Zone to kindly come and receive his award from our dignitaries. Ladies and gentlemen, please kindly put your hands together for our recipient, Sri Satyapal Ji. Very much congratulations. Moving on to the next award for DV Nirmal and Mangal Sen Award for Innovation in Design, Development and Manufacturing of Antenna Systems for Broadcasting. May I please request Sri Manish Jain, Director, NCBS Private Limited, to kindly come and receive his award from the dignitaries. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Sri Manish Jain, the recipient of DV Nirmal and Mangal Sen Award. Congratulations. Our next award is Dr. Vasuman Hazarimal Mirani Award for an Indigenous Workflow Unified News Operation, RNU, DD Ahmedabad. And the recipient is Sri Ramesh Tale and KG Rajiv, Assistant Engineers, DDK Ahmedabad, and his team. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for our recipient, Sri Ramesh Tale and KG Rajiv. Many congratulations to the recipient of Dr. Vasuman Hazarimal Mirani Award. Our next award is a Padmavati Ganesan Award for Automatic Satellite Tracking System. And if I may please call upon Sri D. Godwin Ganaraj, DEDMC, Thrissur. Very, very congratulations, sir, if I may request you to please come and collect your award from our dignitaries. A big applause for our recipients, please. Congratulations, Sri D. Godwin, for receiving Padmavati Ganeshan Award. Congratulations. Moving to the next award, which is a Mukul N. Trivedi Award for Development of Import Substitution for Complex Programmable Logic for 20 kilowatt DRM transmitter. May I request, well, the recipient is Sri S. Niliangam for, he is a DDGE, and Sri C. Mani Marun, EAHPT, All India Radio, Chennai. And on their behalf, may I please request Sri R. Krishnadas, Deputy Director General, Doordarshan Kendra, Chennai, to kindly come and receive the award on their behalf, please. Please, may I request Sri R. Krishnadas, Deputy Director General, Doordarshan Kendra, Chennai, to kindly receive the award, which is the Mukul N. Trivedi Award for Development of Import and Substitution. On that note, may I request the audience members to give an uproar of applause for all the recipients for the BES Awards 2020. On behalf of the entire team of BES, I would like to extend our immense gratitude to our esteemed dignitaries and panelists for gracing the occasion and adding more value to it. And with that, I will request them to accept a small memento as a gesture of our appreciation. With that, may I please request Sri Aftab Ahmed, Honorary Secretary BES, to please facilitate a memento as a token of our appreciation and regards to our guest of honor, Sri Rajiv Singh, Member Finance, Prasar Bharati. Thank you very much, sir, for coming in and for your key address. Thank you very much indeed. May I now request Sri O.P. Rajpurohit, Honorary Treasury for BES, to kindly come and present a memento to our keynote speaker, Ms. Pamela Kumar, Director General, Telecommunications, Standard Development Society of India, and Vice President, Cloud Computing Innovation Council of India, for her key address. Thank you very, very, very much, ma'am, for your very much in-depth and insightful note. Thank you very much. I once again graciously thank our esteemed guests for inaugurating the 26th edition of BES Expo 2020. And if I may request Sri Aftab Ahmadji to please come and share his thoughts with us, please. Please extend a very warm welcome for Sri Aftab Ahmed, Honorary Secretary, BES.
Very good morning, respected guest of honor, Sri Rajiv Singh, Member Finance, Prasar Bharati, keynote speaker, Ms. Pamela Kumar, Director General, TSDSI, President BS, Sri CBS Moria, Engineer in Chief, All India Radio and Doordarshan, distinguished guests, exhibitors, delegates, media persons, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on the inaugural session of 3 days international conference and exhibition on broadcast and media technology. I, on behalf of Broadcast Engineering Society, extend a big thanks to Ms. Pamela Kumar, Director General TSDSI, for agreeing to grace the occasion. Her keynote speech on 5G disruptions was really enlightening and addressed the central idea of 5G technology. This has given a kickstart to conference to further deliberate on topic. I must thank Sri Shashi Shekhar Vempati, CEO Prasar Bharati, for sparing his valuable time from his busy schedule. Being head of Prasar Bharati, India's public service broadcaster, He is the torchbearer to the broadcasting fraternity of India. His presence and his kind words has provided guiding power to the broadcasting fraternity present here and great motivation to BS team. I would like to thank Shri Rajiv Singh, Member Finance, Prasar Bharati, for gracing and addressing the gathering on disruptions due to technology advancement. Sir, days are not far when we may hear Alexa and Shri have become friends speaking Bhojpuri. I must thank Shri CBS Moria, President Broadcasting Engineering Society and Engineer-in-Chief All India Radio and Doordarshan. He has been a constant source of inspiration and guidance to entire team of Broadcast Engineering Society. I can see very senior broadcasters, professionals in the audience from various international and national organizations. My special thanks to them for being here. I would like to thank delegates, exhibitors, media person, and all the ladies and gentlemen present here. Well, ladies and gentlemen, an event like this cannot happen overnight. The wheels start rolling weeks ago. It requires planning and a bird's eye for details. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of very motivated and dedicated colleagues of Broadcast Engineering Society. We know their jobs, and are result-oriented. I thank all of them for their hard work, involvement, and their willingness to take on the completion of tasks beyond their comfort zone. The last but not the least, I thank ITPO for providing such a good place for the event and very supporting team. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. That was Shri Aftab Ahmed. Thank you very much, sir. May I please request Shri CBS Maurya ji to kindly say a few words to us.
I would request all delegates and everybody to be available for the tutorials today, which is starting at 2 p.m. A very important session is there, and I think that it will be beneficial to everybody. So my request is that everybody should attend it. Thank you.
As the inaugural ceremony draws to its end, I will now invite the esteemed dignitaries to officiate the inauguration of the exhibition, please.